Oh, smell that? Airline fuel. It's almost like an aphrodisiac.
My name is Lorraine Simpson, and I am passionate about travel. My obsession has taken me to 92 countries over the last 53 years, and I am now devoted to helping the travel industry recover in a post-pandemic world.
So I'm at the airport here at Toronto Pearson International, and what I'm going to do is walk you right from the curb all the way through. We're going to go through the security, we're going to go through the checkpoints, we're going to see what Toronto has done to make you safe. But that's not where it stops. After that, guess what Lorraine is doing? Lorraine is going on a plane. One of the touch points I really want to tell you about as we talk all day today about safety, arriving at an airport, departing from an airport, and everything that the airport has put in place for you just to be safe, is the limo. You're arriving in a limo or even a taxi, make sure you use a licensed one, because what they've done is they've made all these improvements to keep you safe. So this is a plastic barrier, and this barrier is all airtight. So somebody sneezes at the front, you're good. You want to pay? No problem. Lift up this little lap here and you can put your money through. Visa machine right there. Very easy. This is an air quality monitoring station. The air is sucked in every 5 minutes and it is checked in real time. And you can actually check it for yourself right on their website. So this air is as good quality as it is inside a hospital. I mean, these guys are really taking this stuff seriously. They're even using UV light sterilization inside the HVAC system. Good morning. We are traveling to Montreal.
Okay, can you have some?
Yes, I can, with pleasure. There's 400 hand sanitizing stations in this airport. All right, touch free. Okay, this is very cool. So this is different. It says, please scan your boarding pass barcode. And I think I'm gonna put that under there. Oh, that's it?
That's it.
No way! This is very good. Get my bag on here. Step back. How easy is that? That's really cool, I love it. Literally scan my boarding pass, put my bag on here, went straight through, done. Costume change, I'm not compromising safety for fashion. Even my mask has to match the dress, of course, you know. But in all seriousness, guys, make sure you bring a couple of changes of outfits with you. When you are traveling, you never know when you're gonna spill something or something's gonna happen. Take a change of clothes with you, put it in your carry-on, then you can change if you need to. I just got too hot running around finding all the information for you guys. Okay, I'm gonna go through the fogging corridor. It's disinfecting, non-toxic, water-based, and very refreshing. I have my little bag that Air Canada gives you when you get on board. It's got clean care, it's got our water, hand sanitizer, and a mask, and even cute little pink gloves, which I think are just adorable. Now, there are drink services available on board now, and in business class, they're gonna give you a box with some food in it too. Now, I brought this along with me. This is a fabulous little neck pillow, but what I like about this is it rolls up to nothing. And then you're gonna blow it up because inside here is a little bladder pack, which I can take this whole thing out and wash this every time.
The air inside the cabin is a mix of 50% fresh air, 50% cabin air, and it's refreshed every 2 to 3 minutes, 20 to 30 times an hour. To ensure passenger safety, air comes out from the top, forces everything to the bottom, and it comes out through the return vents. In this aircraft, we have 3 HEPA filters. 2 are located here in the belly of the aircraft in the forward cargo, and 1 is located in the main cabin ceiling.
All the bags are sprayed, by the way, but they are social distancing the bags because ours is taking a little bit longer to come through than others, so...
So now that we know about all the extra safety measures that are in place, I go from Toronto, Ontario to Victoria, BC.
So we just got off the Dreamliner and now gonna get onto this cute little plane that almost looks like it's a Flintstone plane. And I have to put my feet through the bottom and then run along the runway to make it go. Dog bar and grill. You know, when I was a kid, we used to. We've done it with you too.
How many legs?
So whenever we did a. No, it's not how many heads. It's how many legs, because the Queen's head only has one head.
Exactly.
So no, but if you got the coach and horses, then you got lots of points. So it was always about, you know, you wanted something with 4 legs, or you wanted the nuns and the bishop or something, or.
Octopus gang bar and grill.
The what? The octopus? Yeah, but that's not something that we call that in England.
Many octopuses.
No, it had to have lots of arms and legs, and
yes,
then you earned points.
Yes.
So then you would have the next person would then have the next pub that we came to, and of course in England every little village has 2 pubs, so it was easy to do. But you do that in Canada, you're waiting for a pub for about 20 kilometres or something. Do on this island is to go whale watching. So this morning, Lorraine is going on a boat. Now, you might think I'm a little overdressed, but actually, it's gonna be cold out there. So I have my gaiter on, I'm gonna put my woolly hat on top, and we're off to find some whales. And this company, Eagle Wings, guarantees it 100%. So let's take them up on it.
You like this hat? A lot of people don't like this hat. Makes people angry.
I don't like it.
Our boat was a private charter, and as long as we socially distanced from the captain, we were allowed to remove our masks.
So sometimes you have to sacrifice a bit of glamour for a really cool experience.
It's a bit chilly.
So the island right behind me is called Darcy Island, and in the 1800s it was used as a leper colony, and then after that, when all the lepers had gone and gone onto the mainland, it was actually used during Prohibition to store all of the illegal alcohol between Canada going off to the United States.
So we're just now entering into Georgia Strait, just super rich area of food for all these animals. We do get quite a few humpbacks that do congregate in this area because, the abundance of food. But other types of animals we do get in this area, orcas, we do get some minkies that move through, and we will be passing and seeing a lot of harbor porpoise. We have huge groups of harbor porpoise kind of congregating up, and they're all going after the same food. So what they're going after is the small bait fish, herrings running, needlefish, all different types of this real oily, fatty, food that these humpbacks need.
So that other boat over there, our other boat, did they see the whales first? Is that who's calling the shots?
They're the ones who advised us that there were animals going through active pass. These were animals that were actually picked up by a fellow whale watcher on the BC ferries heading to Vancouver this morning. And he was able to pick them up going through active pass. So one great thing, again, all the companies, we work together, the drivers work together to make sure that everybody gets the best sightings and all the intel so we can offer the best trip.
So we're just waiting for the whales to come up, and round here it's a bit like a buffet for humpback whales, and they can eat between 1 to 2 tons of food a day. So they usually stay around here underwater about between 5 and 12 minutes. Down in the tropics they can stay underwater for an hour, but here usually about 5 to 12 minutes. Slap a bit of lippy on and you'll be fine. So the weirdest thing just happened. We're on calm water, and then this current arrived, and now we're in like a whirlpool, and even though the boat is actually in neutral, it's just spinning us in a circle. I'm a little bit afraid that any minute now it's gonna suck us right under and we're gonna find Amelia Earhart down there somewhere in the ocean. Okay, so we're back. That was so much fun. Don't worry about doing your hair before you go. You really won't need to. But one of the things I will say is dress warm. It gets very cold on the boat, but we were very well prepared. They gave us tons of notice in advance. We took gloves and hats and coats and everything. We were completely fine. But this company, Eagle Wings, are the only carbon neutral whale watching company in Canada. Fabulous experience, fabulous day, an absolute must do when you visit Victoria. A little quick stop here because this beach is absolutely covered in driftwood. Honestly, I could get a fortune for pieces like this. Got bloody sand in my knickers now. Good God. We're going wine tasting today, but if we start with the cider, that's a bit like having fruit first, no? It's a bit like breakfast. It's fruits, apples, it's like breakfast. So I could say something like that.
You just did.
I just did. So I have 12 here. I think it might be a bit of a long day starting out with this, but it's great because I've got all my drinks to try and all these tastings, and then I have a beautiful charcuterie board. Oscar! Really? That's to share, you know?
I can't drink it, so I eat.
Okay, let's start. So, I think the first one is Wild English. I'm a bit of a Wild English person, so let's try. Do you have Wild English there, Oscar? Cheers.
And apple juice.
I'm gonna go through every single one, and then when I get the one that I love the most, I'm gonna down it.
To put pickles.
He's put pickles in the favorite one. Where to next?
Mm-hmm.
So what are these? What kind of apples are they? And they look red to me. Are they ready to eat or anything?
Not quite. Our harvest season is going to be later this month, all the way through September and October.
Nice.
Each row here in this orchard is a different type of apple, but mostly they fall into the category of bittersweet or bitter sharp. Those make the best cider for sure.
Bittersweet.
I wouldn't recommend eating them just because they're very, very bitter.
Right.
But the kind of general rule of thumb is if it doesn't taste good to eat, it probably makes pretty good cider. And if it tastes good to eat, it's probably not great for cider.
You know, it's funny because in England we have an apple called the Bramley apple.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't possibly eat it, but it makes the best applesauce.
Yeah.
But they're not grown in North America.
No, but that is what we're inspired by. So traditional English ciders. Our owner actually lived in Wales for a while. And that's where she fell in love with the traditional dry, bitter English ciders. And that's why we're here today.
Oscar!
Honestly, let him do it. It's worth it. It's gonna taste really bad. Yeah.
Can you hear that? Silence. Well, you know what? I'm in the woods, but I'm not going for a jog, and I'm not going for a walk through the woods because I'm about to head out wine tasting, which is way more my thing. But if it's your thing to go off the beaten path and into the woods, look at this, right here in BC. This, people, is Canada.
Does size really matter?
We do tours in a Tesla.
Great, that's lovely. Thank you.
And we mainly do winery tours, so Cowichan Valley wine tours on Vancouver Island.
So they get in the car in the morning, like us, and they're all quiet and subdued and looking for coffee.
And then
by the time they end up the touring, they're like falling out of the Tesla, wondering why the doors open upwards instead of outwards and sideways.
They get in the Tesla as an introvert and leave as an extrovert.
Isn't this the Tesla that does the celebration mode at the end of it? You're like...
It does, and I looked on my phone and I know how to do that now. So
gosh, we're going to do that then. We're celebrating the fact that you're all sloshed. Go taste some wine. Actually, no, we're gonna go and taste some sparkling wine, which is even better for me. So, what's the difference between the stuff that you make and the stuff that they make in the Champagne region of France? Where are we going?
It's very similar. We have really nice high acid here on the island because of the wet springs. Acid is maintained in the soils, and the fruit has a long time to gain energy. In the early spring, with a lot of moisture in the air as well as in the soils. This is a Chardonnay here. Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, Muscat, and Pinot Gris.
Isn't it on the same geographical line as like the Champagne region?
Yes, very similar, and the climate's very similar to Burgundy.
Okay.
Here as well.
And is it made in the same method of Champagne, like
yes,
the method Champagne was, or?
Yeah, what's not all wineries make it traditionally. There's a Charmat method, there's traditional method, there's, we are traditional.
Here. Right.
So we've got the Riddling Racks, and we've just received our neck freezer.
So how long does it take to make a bottle of sparkling wine?
Yeah, it's basically, it is a vintage wine, so every year we will do it. So it's very similar to making a still wine, except for the processes in the cellar are a little bit different. So they're bottling right now Pinot Gris that was harvested last year. So they've gone through the year-long process of being in bottle, secondary fermentation during riddling, and they're bottling right now. This is actually seen as one of the top wedding facilities in BC, especially the largest winery on the island. Due to COVID, we've had to cancel, I think it was 18 to 22 weddings this year, but they've all rebooked for next year.
So. Nice. like you have to really connect with people emotionally, and this definitely is a connection emotionally. I think champagne is always that, isn't it? It's always really gets you. But it's like Say Yes to the Dress, you know, you go in, you try a dress on for a wedding, you come out, you look lovely, nothing, go back, try another one on, come out, look lovely, go back, try another one out, and then tears. But there's no real difference. It's just that connection, that emotional connection. When I tasted this, this reminds me of really good French champagne. And it surprised me. I did not expect that, I have to admit. I did not expect this kind of quality from a Canadian wine producer that grows it right there.
It's also helpful that our winemaker, Arnold Deary, is from Bordeaux region of France. So he's been here. His first true vine to bottle is coming out in the fall here, his first true vintage. But he did come in and finish the wines that were in tank and some of that were in barrel. We're very, very lucky to have him.
Okay, well, thanks for visiting Invinity Sparkling Wine House. So we're the only dedicated sparkling wine house on the island, and in BC there's one other, Bella, who's also an amazing place. We only make four products. We use just Peninsula grapes, and we blend. So we do traditional method only, and we follow French style of blending. So at the end of all our ferments, we kind of take our time and just taste. It's a bit of a drinking game, and decide what we want it to taste like, and then we end up with that blend. So something that we're also doing, since we're right by the ocean, we're going to be dropping about 50 bottles into the ocean to Ocean H, calling it. There's some theories and like some studies around there. That's the cage there.
They do that in Croatia.
Do they? Yeah. See, like I've heard of a couple people doing studies, and Vuvkla Co's doing like a 50-year study in the ocean too. Just something to do with like the movement. So we're going to have land age versus like ocean age.
And see which it is.
Yeah, and check it out, right? Yeah.
So we just walked in and I noticed classical music, which we just killed, but yeah. So is that similar to, you know, growing plants and you're supposed to sing to it or something like
that?
That's
the theory, yeah, our theory behind it, and we've seen other positive affirmation type things where you're like, we put on our barrels and our tanks like lovely Pinot Gris and all that type of stuff. Just that theory behind it, thinking that's gonna like impart itself. It's a living thing, so we think that comes through in it, but yeah. Okay, so this is, two Riddling Rocks. We had a local builder make them, so they're not like perfect, but he's a friend who does woodworking from that, so they're made from there. So the intent of these, after they've aged in the little tiny bedroom there, and then they come on here and to get the actual lees out of the bottle. So that's the goal here. So that takes about 2 weeks, and we get the lees down to the neck.
So you don't freeze yours, you do it a different way.
Yeah, okay. We do it like what they call warm disgorging from that.
Okay.
And same with Bella up in Nearmeadow, he does the same thing, he actually taught us.
All right, ready? Champagne, so I'm gonna steal it. Ah! I can do it! Ah! Shit! I can't even move the bloody thing. How much champagne you got in this? Good God! Endless supply of champagne, check. And now I've picked up a bit of food along the way, so I have everything I need for for a picnic on the lawn on a Saturday afternoon at the Empress Hotel in Victoria. They've even got a dinner bell. Hear the dinner bell? Right. Dinner, grubs up. Here we go, picnic on the lawn. There's all kinds of goodies in here. You probably need a bit of food to soak up all this champagne and sparkling wine and wine we've had all day today. It's just been a day of drinking. Maybe I should start with the water. Champagne first. What if you've got a saber? I'm quite good now. I can saber it off. So if you don't want to have a picnic on the lawn, this is something that is absolutely iconic to the Empress Hotel. It is traditional British afternoon tea, and of course, being British, I am definitely the queen of afternoon tea. And on this tray, we have all the traditions. So you've even got cucumber cream cheese sandwiches, smoked salmon, little pinwheel sandwiches here, and then we've got coronation chicken, which I absolutely love coronation chicken. And then the second course, so really, it should be flipped. I'm going to be very, very cheeky here. Should be flipped like this. Because actually, you start at the bottom and you have the savory stuff first. And then you move on to the scones with jam and cream. Note, I said scones, not scones. That's how the Queen says it. So you break them in half and you put the clotted cream and the jam. I'm a cream first and jam second. Same as the Queen, has to be right. And then on the top here, we've got little cakes, little mini cakes, little lavender cake here and a cherry cake, and this is an almond cake, and it's all supposed to be served together. And it actually was really originated in England in 1840, when the Duchess of Bedford, who would have lunch at about midday, and then dinner would be served at about 8 o'clock at night. So she decided, well, I'm actually hungry in the middle of the day. So she asked the servants to provide her with some snacks to be served in her bedroom. And then it became a ladies' afternoon tea tradition. And now, even these days in England, if you go to England, if you go to London, it is a tradition to have afternoon tea. And it's absolutely one of my favorite things to do. So that's it, that's the end of our trip to Victoria, BC. Had a fantastic time, ate some great food, saw some brilliant whales on our whale watching, and tasted some great wine. What a wonderful way to spend a few days here in Victoria, BC. Wow.